Hi everyone, welcome to Bold Conjectures with Parush Chopra. Today I'm with Ganesh Bagler, who is a professor at Indraprastha University Institute of Information Technology in Delhi, India. He's pioneering a new field called computational gastronomy, which combines machine learning, data, and food. He holds a PhD in computational biology from Center of Cellular and Molecular Biology. Food traditionally evolved through hit and trial. Someone kept bread outside for a day and the next day tasted really well and something new was invented. Similarly for beer, pizza and lots of such foods. I mean, over thousands of years, our cuisines have evolved and nobody knows why the cuisines are the way they are. Maybe it's because of taste, nutrition, antimicrobial properties, and just so many reasons why these got selected in a very hidden, not so obvious processes. So what Professor Ganesh is doing is trying to use data to unravel why food is the way it is. And hopefully his research can lead us to making new types of foods that haven't even been invented. And I think that's what I'm personally excited about, innovating in such a core part of human experience. Interestingly, it's not being innovated so much, but I'm very excited that people like Ganesh are working on it. And I can't wait to sort of interview him on various things. So welcome, Professor Ganesh.
Thank you, Paras. It's my pleasure also to be on your podcast, which is heard by so many, and they are excited to know about new ideas through you. So I am also pretty excited to convey what is happening in the broad umbrella of computational gastronomy in my lab.
Right. So let's begin with this only. I mean, what is computational gastronomy? How do you define it? And what is the span of this field?
I define computational gastronomy as a data science which blends food with data and the power of computation for achieving data-driven food innovations. I know it's a mouthful, but essentially it tries to blend, put together food with something unconventional, which is data and computational algorithms for achieving data-driven food innovations. It's a fairly applied area that we are trying to develop. However, it does ask some fundamental questions, such as why do we eat what we eat?
Right. That's a really important question.
Absolutely. And to talk about the span of computational gastronomy, it tries to look at basic questions such as the one which I just mentioned about why do we eat what we eat, as well as applied questions. For example, can we develop a universal food or a beverage which will be liked by a lot many people? Can I develop a product which will be liked by, say, French people vis-a-vis Indians and other way around? Can we do such innovations? Similarly, can we predict the taste of a molecule, a small molecule, so that we can go in a direction where we can come up with artificial sweeteners, just to give another illustration. Can we make healthy food, food which is healthy against, say, lifestyle disorders such as diabetes, obesity, heart cardiovascular disorders? Can we design such food? Such are the broad questions that we ask, which encompass culture, flavor, cuisines, taste, as well as health aspect of food.
Right. So before we get into what you're learning and how you're applying it, I was curious to know how you got into computational gastronomy. You were, and I think you still research in computational biology. And so this seems very distant from what you've trained for. So how did you end up getting interested in this?
Yeah. And if you get into what I'm trained for, then I would go a step back beyond my PhD training, which is in computational biology. I have been trained in physics. And in fact, as a teenager, I was an aspiring astronomer. So okay. It's been a journey from astronomy to gastronomy. I was always wanting I wanted to do research in astronomy and astrophysics, and I in fact did apply for various places but never got selected in way back in 1999 is what I'm referring to, right? And through a journey of MTech in computational techniques and then being selected in interdisciplinary area of computational biology, it's a long journey. I have not been a foodie, which is what people consider me, given the fact that I have devoted last 6 to 7 years of my academic career as well as personal life for investigating food. So it happened serendipitously. So to answer your question, it happened in a classroom. So I was teaching where I was an assistant professor at IIT Jodhpur in 2014 winter. I still remember it was a heterogeneous class of computer scientists, mechanical engineering students and others to whom I was teaching a class on complex networks. And to give an illustration of what a network is, I pulled out a relatively recently published paper that was in 2011, which investigated what is called as flavor graph. And while discussing flavor graph and cuisines of western part of the world, I realized that the Indian cuisine hasn't been investigated with a similar intensity, with a similar kind of scientific rigor. That's when I started postulating certain questions in the context of Indian cuisine, and the journey began. The rest is history, if I look back, including coining the term computational gastronomy.
Yeah. I mean, it's such an entrepreneurial attitude, and completely how entrepreneurs do, wherein finding an opportunity to make a difference and running after it, irrespective of whether you have background or not. I think that's really amazing that you're doing something similar in academic research, where traditionally people don't jump their sort of fields as much. I really saw this as an entrepreneurial sort of mindset, wherein, you know, entrepreneurs, where they see an untapped opportunity, they run after that opportunity irrespective of where they're coming from. And I think very similarly for you, wherein you found a field that was ripe for making a difference, and you went after it, which is quite unusual in academic research, from what I know.
Indeed. I derived inspiration from somebody called Nassim Nicholas Taleb, if you must have heard about him, and his philosophy called anti-fragile philosophy, and something called barbell philosophy. So I did pursue my research in that way, by which I was essentially doing some computational biology research to investigate certain complex diseases. But at the same time, along with my young partners, who are my undergraduate students and postgraduate students, I was also investigating certain peripheral questions which are thoroughly of entrepreneurial nature, as you rightly said. And in fact, I take it as a compliment, because it doesn't come naturally to every researcher, an academician. So that's how it came about. You are right about it. And having identified an opportunity in this area, which was not named until then when we started, we took inspiration from the fact that this can transform food as we see it. And I have been working on this, on putting the foundations of computational gastronomy for the last 6 to 7 years. That's right.
Okay. So I think the next question I wanted to ask was the most basic question that you can imagine, in the sense, what exactly is food? And once you define it, how exactly do you go about modeling it in data so that something can be done with it? So really, what is food, and how do you model food?
Right. When you look at food, one can see it as a nutrition. One can see it as a cultural artifact, which has evolved over a few tens of thousands of years. A combination of ingredients which are put together in a specialized manner. A recipe which has come to us thanks to the wisdom of our forefathers who have put it together. So there are various ways of looking at food, from food science, technology perspective, from artistic endeavor, from a culinary perspective, in terms of how do you modify certain ingredient combinations to come up with a delicious recipe or a new recipe altogether. So when I look at food, I try to incorporate all these aspects, which are partly coming from anthropological cultural side, as well as some which are coming from science and technology side. So I see food as a multi-dimensional beast. And while we take it granted, it has become central to not only how we nourish ourselves, but also the lifestyle disorders that have come to the fore in the recent past, which includes type 2 diabetes, obesity, cardiovascular disorders. So that's the perspective I take when I look at food. And the view that we came up with in 2015 when we investigated Indian cuisine and came up with some interesting phenomena of how spices are central to the food pairing mechanism in Indian cuisine, that became a rage. It was kind of taken up by the media all over the world, and the typical title which would go for a newspaper article was "Scientists have figured out why Indian food is tasty." So we would be amused by the kind of exaggerations which were made by the media. But at the same time, I realized that there is a huge scope for building the data-driven foundation of this new area. There is a dearth of databases which are structured, which are queryable, which can be used as a basis for doing computational investigation, applying tools such as machine learning and AI, broadly speaking. So that is when we started putting together repertoires, data repertoires of recipes, of flavor compounds, of health associations of the food. So that is how we have been building this whole area in bits and pieces by, I would call it the jigsaw pieces of the food puzzle. That's what I call it as, to put together the edifice of computational gastronomy.
Right. So could you talk a little bit more about Recipe DB and the Flavor DB, two of the data sources that you've assembled? And also what struck me about your research is very data repository approach, where you focused significantly on building this open and easily available and accessible database first before doing anything else. So was that, I imagine it was a conscious choice, but what motivated that? And what do you hope will be an outcome of putting so much of effort into building this database?
Yes, to begin with, it was a subconscious effort because we were asking questions such as, why do we eat what we eat? I mean, why are the recipes composed the way they are? Why these ingredient combinations and why not others? So while investigating such questions, we had to dig out the flavor data of ingredients, natural ingredients. And when we started digging out the flavor data, we realized that whatever is available up there in the literature is very limited in the scope and it is not comprehensive. And that is when I realized that there is a huge scope for building one of the world's most comprehensive data repository of flavor molecules, which are reportedly found in the natural ingredients, like the tomatoes and chilies. What kind of flavor molecules are they composed of, which is what elicits the taste and the odor that we sense when we eat them or smell them, right? So that was the motivation behind it, to ask certain pertinent questions related to food. And obviously the lack of existing repositories of that sort. That is what triggered us into building such a data repository. So to come to your first question about what is FlavorDB. So FlavorDB looks at natural ingredients which are used in recipes. And there are close to 1,000 of them which FlavorDB puts together. It digs out the data of flavor compounds which are reported from the literature, from the publications and the books, etc. And further, each of these flavor compound itself is associated with certain taste attributes, as they are called, taste and odor attributes, both as they are referred to as, right? For example, a molecule can be having a smell of or a odor and taste, both flavor as burnt, meaty or a similar kind of flavor, right? Attributes, anywhere between 1 to 7, 8 of them, which are attached with them, which are verified by human. It's a human verified data that is already available there. So we have put it together as a layered data, which is importantly interlinked with each other and is queryable. So you can ask a question, tell me what are the molecules which are found in mango? Or you can ask a question, I have this molecule, can you tell me what are the ingredients in which it is found? Or I can ask a question, I have mango or I have tamarind, can you tell me other ingredients which have similar molecules in them?
Okay.
Right? Yeah, such are the questions which can be investigated using FlavorDB. In fact, it is one of the most favorite databases that I've built, because I realized having built it that large number of academicians are using it. That was one of the pleasures of my life, that something that I built out of sheer enthusiasm was something which was extremely useful by people out there, my colleagues, academicians who are working out there. Not only that, the industry folks were finding it useful. So right. I can't name many of the industries who have obviously approached us for licensing it out for commercial purposes, because it's available only for non-commercial academic users at the moment. But commercial purposes, people have been using it. So that's about FlavorDB. In the same manner, you have RecipeDB. Whatever recipe repertoires which are available out there, you know, allrecipes.com, Genius Kitchen, Tarla Dalal in India, and you know, Sanjeev Kapoor, etc. These have human readable recipes. You can go there, read the recipe, appreciate what it is doing, follow the instructions and cook the recipe for yourself, and you know, figure out how well it works out for you. What we wanted as part of our computational gastronomy repository repertoire was a structured and queryable repository, wherein each recipe, we should have a clear labeling, tagging with the cuisine or regional cuisine or country that it belongs to. What is the type of a recipe? Is it a keto recipe or some other type of a recipe that it is? It is. What kind of ingredients are going into it? And ingredient quantity, unit, size, temperature, which has been attached with the ingredient, right? Apart from the sequence with which the ingredients are used. So we, of course, built algorithms, the so-called natural language processing algorithms, which use the so-called named entity recognition techniques to extract structured information from the recipes. And we put it out there for in a searchable manner and connected it with the nutritional information, which is rather limited at the moment. But we have pulled out the information of nutrition from United States Department of Agriculture and are also providing you, the users, the nutritional profile of the recipe. So that's what these two recipe repositories are all about.
Right. And like FlavorDB, it can help answer, I mean, really infinite types of questions, essentially. If I have like tomatoes and bread, what can I make with it? And if you connect it to FlavorDB, then you can even answer if I have X, Y, Z ingredients, how can I make it taste like ABC?
Yeah.
Which just seems very amazing.
In fact, that's what we are trying to do. I would like to tell you that to answer your previous question, it's a conscious choice of building these repositories, because the idea here is that in the process of building individual repositories of FlavorDB, RecipeDB, DietRx, SpiceRx, etc., we are trying to put together various different aspects of food which can be integrated further to come up with what I call internally in my lab as computational gastronomy framework. That's the framework that we are trying to put together.
Okay. So you have this much of data and you've obviously done a lot of research mining. What insights can you get from it? What you can learn about the food? So what have been some of the big surprises that have come up? Maybe you can talk about the research also that about the Indian cuisine that you've figured out, but I'm very curious what have been these aha moments for you that you've learned about food and cuisines and related topics.
Okay, so let me talk about the Indian cuisine to begin with and to tell you about what we have learned from it. So when we investigated Indian recipes, I was not sure about what to anticipate beyond the fact that it's very diverse and is often health conscious and health driven, the traditional Indian recipes, that is what I'm referring to. So when we looked at what could be called as food pairing mechanism, how ingredients or what kind of ingredient combinations tend to go together in Indian recipes, and find what we named as culinary fingerprint, the quintessential pattern that characterizes the recipes from India. When we looked at it, we figured out that beyond any other category which contributes or ingredient of that particular category, whose placement in the recipe can contribute to the special food pairing phenomena that we see in Indian cuisine, it was not vegetable, it was not dairy product, nor it was lentils, but it was more of spices. Spices, we figured out, were the molecular fulcrum of Indian recipes. They were the one which only when consciously used in the way recipe prescribes will end up giving us the food pairing phenomena the way we see it. Otherwise, it won't. That was an interesting result. I wouldn't call it surprising. Because chefs unlike me, who is not a very good cook, only in the learning phase right now, chefs and those who know Indian cuisine very well knew about this observation. I mean, knew about this understanding that you need to place the right spice at the right spot in the recipe, without which the recipe will be broken. It won't have the characteristic feature or taste or odor it would have, right? So for us, it was a surprise to begin with, until the chefs came to us and told us that, you know what, Professor Bagler, what you're doing or what you've found out is something which is very trivial. But at the same time, we appreciate for what you have done, because this is the first time anybody has quantitatively investigated the Indian cuisine and has figured out what is intuitively known to us. So we need to sometimes appreciate that phenomena which are simple to observe otherwise, or simple to look simple. If you were to scientifically investigate, that itself is a big deal. Yes. Because it lays the foundation for asking more questions. So now we can ask the question about what are the flavor molecules which are common across all Indian cuisine? Okay. Which flavor combinations are common? Is there a super Indian food, you know, a generic Indian food which will be liked by all parts of India? You know, these are the kind of questions one can answer having got the answers to the initial or very basic questions that we had asked. So this was one of the aha moments for us, and we were surprised. I mean, initially we were in doubt. We were checking our algorithms back and forth to see if we had made any mistake in the coding part of it, just to ensure that our results are in place. But we figured out that we were on the right spot, and the results were pretty much making sense. So that was one of the aha moments. Please.
So just to see that I understand what you're saying, right? By this fingerprint, you mean in Indian cuisines, if you switch out spices, or maybe you replace one with another, it would make a much larger difference in the taste as compared to the Western cuisine, where some other sort of element may dominate the taste profile.
Yes, true. So yes, you're right. If I were to do, to use a technical word, intra-category shuffling, if I were to shuffle one spice with another spice randomly, then it would change the architecture of Indian recipes dramatically, as opposed to if you were to do the same in the Western cuisines, talk about Europe, where dairy products or dairy category of ingredients dominate. They are the one which are very critical for their food pairing mechanism.
Right. I was reading your research, and maybe this is the right time to get into it, the evolution of cuisines. Just like languages have evolved, you've tried to study how cuisines have evolved. So what motivated you? And again, I know it might be hard to answer why Indian cuisine is the way it is, but what's the hypothesis you have in terms of why would Western cuisine diverge so much from Indian cuisine? Why don't we all in the world eat very similar foods with very similar taste profiles?
In fact, so asking such questions comes naturally to me because thanks to my training in physics, I must say. So it's very easy for a physicist to think about what might have happened, what kind of mechanisms may have operated on the primordial cuisine that must have been present, say 15,000 years back, right at the beginning of agricultural revolution, which has shaped the cuisine the way it is today, and why are they so different from each other, if you ask that question. And of course, why are some cuisines similar to each other? You can ask these questions, right? Answering these questions are very difficult, and the kind of questions or the investigations that we have done while looking into the evolution of cuisines are typical physics-based mechanisms. Like, you start with a random set of cuisines having a random bunch of ingredients, and then you keep on adding a new ingredient to it based on its fitness. So we define fitness as the prevalent frequency or the popularity of the ingredient as its fitness. One of the popular definitions that you can use it as, right? You can use other fitness definitions also. For example, its perceived effect on the health could be another fitness. Its cost could be another fitness. Its availability based on the geography and climate could be another fitness parameter. So there are various ways fitness can be defined. But having defined it in an abstract manner, we started investigating that if I were to put ingredients together in a certain manner by using the so-called copy-mutate algorithm. It's a very simple notion that a recipe is passed on from one generation to another generation, and the next generation, while it copies, may mutate or modify the existing recipe in certain ways. And if that happens, what would happen over a few hundred or thousand generations down the line? That was the question that we were asking. And while doing so, we ended up figuring out that indeed the observed patterns or food pairing patterns in the Indian cuisine can be explained if you were to use a simple copy-mutate model. You don't need any special mechanisms to be in place to be able to observe the cuisine the way it is today. Well, that was one of the observations that we made in the evolution of cuisine. And coming to the second part that you mentioned about, we of course were interested in knowing the relatedness of cuisines and figuring out the cuisine tree, similar to the language tree. I must also point out that this research is at a very primitive stage. While we would like to build a so-called dendrogram, a typical biologist tries to build out of species and how are they related, our understanding of cuisines and the tree is purely based on the culinary fingerprint and how related they are. Mm-hmm. Meaning that Indian cuisine, if it uses spice twice more than what a world cuisine uses, let's say, then are there cuisines which have similar pattern, right? Okay. That is how we try to find out the similarity between the cuisines. And most of it can be explained thanks to the geographical proximity. And the rest has to be explained using cultural takeaways that have happened, transfers that have happened, and partly colonization. That also explains about why certain cuisines are similar to each other.
Right. Yeah, I was looking at the tree and I'll put that same paper in the podcast notes, but I saw African cuisine was related to Indian cuisine in that tree, and it matched my experience when I had Ethiopian cuisine. It was very similar to Indian cuisine, and that got me thinking. I mean, for example, China is much closer to India, but cuisines are so way apart. But Africa and especially Ethiopia is much farther. So it was hard to sort of really understand why would this be, which is obviously the case. So do you have like sort of insight into what non-geographical factors determine cuisine? You said colonization. I mean, that's something I would never even imagine. It's such a counterintuitive insight. Anything else you discovered which determines why do people eat what they eat?
So primarily it was colonization and cultural influences. Please notice one more thing, that cuisines have changed far more dramatically in the last century or two in terms of homogenization, as opposed to what it was, say, around a couple of centuries back. Not much of homogenization had happened until then. But thanks to globalization, cuisines have become more and more homogenized. And we need to appreciate and we need to ask this question about how they might change in the future. So remember, it's not only the experiment of looking into the past, but also trying to peek into the future. That's what we are trying to do with this. So, but barring these two, colonization and cultural takeaways that have happened, such as Mughalai cuisine being incorporated into the northern part of India and being modified further to make it more Indian, which has happened because of the Mughals coming to India, is a classical example by which cuisines have evolved over time.
Right. And so this is something which some of the things you found out, I'm also very interested in learning from you, the applications of what's possible, what's not yet imagined. So is that an area that you're also working on? And in context of that, I think I also heard from one of your talks, this whole concept of personalized food. So what is that, and how would your research lead to something like that?
Well, there are many directions where computational gastronomy, which is essentially data-driven way of looking at food, can take us into. I'll just put them one by one.
Sure.
One is the food-beverage pairing. In fact, one of my early consultancy agreements with a multinational company happened via that. So is it possible for one to come up with predictions about what kind of food might go well with which kind of a beverage, given certain empirical data? Was one of the questions that we asked in our lab. Not to say that this was a hard science. There was a lot of artistic, touch to it in terms of making open-ended predictions and trying to figure out whether it really works that way or not. But that is one direction that one can look at. Designing new food and beverages, individual food products and beverages, is another direction one can think about. You know, can we have the new type of Maggi or Maggi masala, which can entice a large population, is another question that you can ask. I'm just taking Maggi masala as one example, which is a very popular one. You can take any other example that you wish. Similarly, there are other examples. For illustration, one can think of sustainable food innovations. Can we design recipes in a manner that it incorporates local and seasonal ingredients in the recipes? Right, that's one of the very, very interesting question that I would like to ask. Would like to make a repository of local and seasonal in every part of India to begin with, and then of course the rest of the world, and to see what recipes match with that locality and seasonality, such that one can consume that. That's one of the directions that in which we are working towards. Novel recipe generation is one of the most exciting dimension towards which we are always working for the last 1 year or so. The idea here is very simple, that machine learning algorithms, AI driven algorithms, have tried to emulate what is intuitional, what is artistic, trying to recreate Beethoven, trying to recreate Picasso, or trying to recreate AR Rahman, which I will call as AI Rahman, artificially intelligent Rahman. So if one can do that, why can't one do the same in the context of food and recipes, is the question that we are asking. So can we generate or can we train computer by providing the relevant structured recipes, ingredients, flavor information to generate new recipes? And having done that, can we then develop a Turing test for chef? That we have a Turing test in computer science, to identify an intelligent agent. In a similar manner, can one figure out, can we fool a chef into thinking a computer-generated recipe to be a traditional one, a real one, is one of the first step that we are taking. Then, of course, it should be palatable, it should be tasty, and ideally, it should be healthy. So can we take all of these steps one at a time? These are some of the questions. And the last one is about the health part of it, that can we come up with personalized nutrition? And the premise of this particular dimension of food is this, that while classical nutrition literature has believed that a certain kind of diet would lead to, or certain kind of food dish would lead to similar or elicit similar kind of biological response. For example, increase in glucose level. Would that be same if I were to eat idli and you were to eat idli? Well, that's what the classic literature would tell us, dietary practices would tell us. Whereas in reality, it has been found out that eating the same kind of food can elicit different kind of response. Talk about increase in glucose level in you and me, because your body is very different from that of mine. Yeah. And therefore, can I advise a specific recipe that would be useful to me when I'm trying to tackle my type 2 diabetes or trying to avoid type 2 diabetes? That is the direction of personalized nutrition towards which we want to move. But there are so many things to do that, and the resources are so less at our disposal, that we are working on one thing at a time. And this personalized nutrition is on the back burner at the moment in my lab.
Yeah, but I mean, it sounds so exciting that you could take maybe a genetic test and a software can tell you what's the most nutritious, healthiest, most sustainable, and the tastiest. I think the combination of everything we desire from the food, I think that's sort of the holy grail, right? Rather than everyone eating the same things. Everyone eating what's best for them.
Indeed. The day is not too far when that will happen.
I hope you make rapid progress in this, because I think food is so central. And what struck me was when you said sustainable food, because I think not just, not just on the local economy, but even things like climate change, just by impacting our food consumption patterns, because we do it every day, three times a day, you could have an impact on, say, greenhouse emissions by just recommending the right kind of food, which is also tasty. I'm just so happy that you're thinking in this direction. And it would be hard to imagine that something like food can have an impact in such a way, because traditionally things like you shouldn't drive a car and so many other interventions are proposed. But an intervention like change the way you eat it while not sacrificing on taste wouldn't come naturally.
You're right about it. So food is extremely central to our lifestyles. And I believe that applying the data-driven innovations, which is, we are in 21st century. Data has changed different aspects of our lives, right? From tagging on Facebook to logging in MacBook, everything has changed. So why not food? So why not food? We should change food also in a similar manner. And who else, somebody has to begin that journey. Yes. And I realized that not too many people are in this game. And that's another early mover advantage that we can gain out of it. That's what has happened in my lab. So we are considered to be the founding lab and the ground zero of computational gastronomy. Not to mention there are many other global players, both academic as well as industry players, who are operating in this domain. But I'm happy to be one of the labs, and that too, largely Indian origin lab which has worked on this domain. Not to talk about the patriotism, but to say that it's a phenomena that has grown pretty much in and around India. So I'm happy about it that world is taking notice of it.
Right. So I was curious, when we talk about food, it's so personal. And have you had objections from people where they say you're trying to sort of mess up with something which is so close to culture, tradition? When we talk about optimized food, I can imagine it would generate all sorts of responses. So I'm curious if you get this objection, or how do you handle it?
You're right. And many of these objections I personally sympathize with. So to begin with, let me tell you, when we looked at Indian cuisine and investigated it from food pairing perspective, and did something interesting out of it, observed something very cool out of it. People asked, how dare you call Indian cuisine? You have taken 2,543 recipes out of the blue and you are calling them Indian cuisine? How dare you do that? Indian cuisine is far deep, far more diverse and rich compared to what you're trying to look at. I completely agree on that. I, in fact, completely agree with that aspect. And I'm trying to come up with a repository of traditional recipes, authentic traditional recipes from different part of India. And there are many others who are trying to do the similar job, by the way. However, my intention is to make it computationally intensive as well. My lab's motto is making food computable. It's a three-word tagline, if you wish. Which conveys the aspirations with which we are operating in my lab. So this was one of the objections from the representative nature of Indian cuisine. What is it representative at all? So to an extent, it was representative because we had looked at recipes coming from different regional cuisines, but it was never comprehensive. Can I have a comprehensive recipe repository? I don't think so. It's impossible, given the fact that there are hundreds of varieties of rasams and sambars which are made in South India. And in similar manner, you will find different recipes, which standard recipes, which come from different parts of India as well as different other parts of the world, which have variations in them, right? Especially in India and some other oriental cultures, we tend to have these variations as opposed to a typical French recipe, which is locked into a particular rubric. You just follow that strictly. Right? We have variations. So how can you capture all of that is one of the questions, one of the objections. Coming to the other part of it, food is emotional. My mother's food, is a catchphrase, right? What my mother cooks, how can you mechanize it? You are stripping away my emotional layer from the food. It was one of the objections. My point is that the idea is not to mechanize food, but the idea is to automate, learn from the traditional food that we have so that we can make it better, we can make it healthier, right? I wouldn't necessarily say this, but there are companies who are trying to recreate your mother's recipe. Tomorrow there can be a program and a machine together when your mother will program into that particular mechanism, ways of cooking, and that would be emulated by that particular machine so that you can eat your mother's food anytime and anywhere that you wish to, right? People are trying to do that. And I can see how it is theoretically possible. Although there are people who object to it, saying that, let me tell you, use the exact word which was used by one of the popular food writer. She said that andaaz bhi koi cheez hoti hai. So, you know, estimate has certain value when you're cooking, right? But yeah. At the same time, I believe that without quantification, without measuring, computational gastronomy and anything related to computational gastronomy can't move forward. So yeah. These are some of the objections that I told you, which have been raised in the context of what we are trying to do. And also to say that when I say that this is my daredevil conjecture, that computers will be able to generate recipes which are human-like. So people are saying that you are going to remove the chef out of the picture. The idea is not that. Idea is to enable the chef to generate newer recipes with the help of a computer. That's what we are trying to do.
Yeah, I think with these types of tools, the possibilities explode. I mean, you're just sort of making the food space much more bigger than what it is right now. That, chefs would get so many more directions to explore. Yep. Versus what they have now. And I do think what you're doing is somewhat inevitable because AI has changed radically so many areas, right from translation to voice recognition and so many other things. Doing this for food, it just seems that we have to grapple with the fact that this is somewhat inevitable. Yes. And we make the best out of it. So Professor Bagla, I wanted to come back and once again talk about science of food. So I was curious, what are the biggest unsolved questions that you would love to answer through your research about food? What is that, you know, something you keep thinking about, which might be, which is something you would eventually like to get to, and maybe something that as a community that you're building of computational gastronomy are the biggest questions that, and I'm asking because if any of the listeners is interested, these questions could become the hook that they can maybe start doing or exploring with their own research, or maybe talk to you if they're interested in joining your lab and so on.
Indeed. I insist, first of all, before answering your question, that this is a movement. This is a journey. This can't be a one man's aspiration. Definitely not. Lot of people, intellect of a lot of people, intuition of a lot of people, efforts from them would be needed to be able to make a lot of things that I mentioned a reality. Right? So we are trying to make these databases openly available for academic purposes, while at the same time, for obvious reasons, we are trying to find ways by which we can monetize it at the same time, because there are certain companies who would like to, or organizations which would like to use it for commercial endeavors. And this is a community that we're trying to build. We are trying to make this data accessible to them. Having said that, what are the questions that we are asking? And those are not answered yet. Yeah. I believe even now, why do we eat what we eat is not fully answered. We started with that question and we made a simplification in the question. We had only looked at ingredient combinations, right? So a lot of data which is required to answer this question is not available. What are the flavor profiles of ingredients when they are baked, boiled, sauteed, fried, etc., are not available yet. They are available only in the raw form and only in certain processed form. For example, for beef, you would have boiled and roasted one, but you won't have other flavor profiles, just to quote one example. To have such repository is one of the one of the efforts that I am wanting to work towards. And this cannot happen without the help of the government or the industry or both. So that is one thing that we are trying to work on, about why do we eat what we eat? The answer is not fully available there.
Okay.
Can we generate healthy recipes using, with the help of computer, is another question. We are able to emulate recipe patterns that are with which the computer is trained, but how do you make a recipe authentic to make it palatable is another question that is unanswered yet, and we are trying to work on that as well. Can you predict what will be the shape of the cuisines in the decades to come by based on the way they have evolved until now is another question that we are asking. And again, there are the models that we have developed are so simple and so trivial that we believe there is a huge scope for improvising them further to be able to answer this question. And personalized nutrition is another question where experimentation is required in different parts of the world, different cuisines, to be able to figure out how individuals, subjects who are part of these trials, wherein they consume different kind of food, how do their body parameters, measurable body parameters, which are reflecting their health indicators, such as postprandial glucose level, increasing glucose level post-meal, changes, happens upon consuming a certain kind of food, thereby we reaching to a personalized nutrition. So these are some of the range of questions which perhaps I had already touched upon that we are still working on. And can we develop a superfood? That is one of the questions which industry asks me. Can you develop a food composition or a food which has got a flavor profile which will be liked by everyone? One, I did not mention a couple of them, which are extremely important from the industry perspective. How do you reduce salt and sugar while still maintaining an attractive flavor profile of an ingredient or a food? That's another question that has to be answered. So, a broad range of questions that I must
Great. So I think I wanted to end this conversation with sort of a personal question. How has your experience with food changed in the last 5-6 years since you've started this research? Do you experiment with your own food? Have you seen yourself changing as a person because of what you've learned about food?
Eminently. As I said, I started as a food agnostic. So I would rather eat anything that is easily available to me, right? Over time, having realized food and different facets of food, whether it is flavor, nutrition, health impact of food, etc., obviously, I'm far more conscious in what I'm eating. When it comes to experimentation, I haven't done as much as I would love to do, but I have improved upon my cooking skills compared to what it was earlier. And I wish to be in a place where beyond doing cooking in silico cooking, I should be able to do cooking in kitchen as well, as much, with similar rigor as that of a chef. So that's where I would like to reach.
Right. I mean, my image of you was like in your kitchen, it'll be like a scientist lab where you're generating recipes through AI, trying it. And I think that would be awesome if you sort of have an experimental side to your research as well.
Indeed. That's what we expect to do and reach a place where we can actually start cooking. But it's daunting, I must say, as I told you, to reach that place. But right now we are focusing too much on the data-driven aspect of it before reaching the kitchen. Yeah.
Right. So thank you so much, Professor Bagla. It's been an absolute pleasure talking to you about everything you've done. I really hope you get to answering these questions, helping build more sustainable, healthy, nutritious, tasty food. It's such a central place to everyone's heart that I can't imagine not having enough resources to be able to do that. So I do hope governments and industry come together to help accelerate your path. And I will link your research papers and Twitter on the podcast. So I hope everyone goes and follows what you're doing.
Yeah.
And hopefully some of the people will get enough interested to sort of even perhaps join your lab or contact you for further information.
Sure. Thank you for having me on your podcast, Paras. It's a pleasure to be talking to you and to discuss different aspects of food and computational gastronomy. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great day. Bye-bye.
Yeah, bye-bye.